morning, Your Honors. Jeremy Robinson, appearing on behalf of the plaintiffs and appellants in this case. I'd like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal, if I could, please.
Please watch the clock.
I will, thank you. This is a very broad area to deal with. There's a lot that happens in arbitration law in a very short period of time, so I was hoping that maybe one of the things I can do to help guide the court here is talk about a couple of cases that have come out since the briefs have been filed, since I believe the briefs really addressed the issues as well as they could. First, I want to mention a couple of California Supreme Court cases.
Have you made these available to us by way of a 28-J letter?
I have not, Your Honor, only because there are so many new things that have come out that I wasn't sure that it would be appropriate to inundate the court with a huge swath of cases.
You're not going to inundate us right now, correct?
Correct. I'm only going to mention two cases.
And did you give those by way of a 28-J letter?
I did not, Your Honor.
Well, did the other side get notice that you were going to rely on these cases?
I
don't believe so. See, that's what a 28-J letter is for, among other things. That way you don't spring something on your colleague at the last minute. But go ahead.
Okay. I understand, Your Honor, and I apologize for that. I imagine they're aware of them. They did actually bring to your attention the DirecTV case, I believe, by way of that letter. Understand. The Sanchez case and the Carbajal case, these are two California cases. And really, there's no need to go into any detail about these other than the fact that they reaffirm that the unconscionability doctrine remains in full effect in California, despite Concepcion and the cases that have come after.
Both prongs.
Both prongs, yes, Your Honor. And so that takes me to the particular facts of this case. And I thought maybe a good way to approach this is, because we have to treat arbitration as being the same as any other form of remedy, then a good way to look at it is to remove arbitration from the process and just think of what the agreement would look like without arbitration being a factor, and instead just consider the various terms that the defendant has sought to impose here.
Well, what's the product that we're talking about?
The product is a consumer DNA test product. So you buy the product off of the website. At that particular time, you don't have to agree to the terms of service. You just buy the product.
That's what I mean, product. It's a kit?
Correct, it's a kit.
Is it in the record somewhere that I can see it?
I don't believe there's any sort of...
I couldn't find it.
Yeah, there's no...
Right,
no.
So I go on the internet, something directs me to this thing, whatever it is, and what do I see? What am I buying?
You're buying just a testing kit. It's a saliva test kit.
And so what does that look like? It's a plastic thing, and you spit it in or something and send it in?
Pretty much, yes.
So when you go on there, you see the saliva test kit, right?
Yes.
But that's not really what you're buying. You're buying a service.
Ultimately, yes.
And what's the saliva test kit for?
The saliva test kit, so you send the saliva back to 23andMe at some point in time, and they test it, they run your DNA, and Mr. Farrion can maybe give you the technical details of what exactly tests they run, but what they advertise, at least, is that when they do that, they can then give you some information about your DNA ancestry, and at least at this time, when this was taking place, they also claimed that they could take
stuff. Yeah.
All
right, so when you go on there and you see the kit, they say, buy this kit, you can get all these things. What do you do then? You buy the kit. How do you do that?
So you purchase the kit online.
How do you do that?
Just by going to their website, entering presumably your credit card information or something like that.
And so once you enter it, then you've paid for it right on the spot?
Correct.
So that commercial transaction is complete at that time, isn't it? You bought the kit. Now, is this kit something that people put on antiques roadshows or on their shelves at home to show everybody?
No.
It's a means to an end, correct?
Correct.
Now, is there anything at all when you buy the kit, when you put in your credit card information, that alerts you that you may be waiving your right to go to court if you get cheated or you have some problem with the company?
No. There is a link, a hyperlink at the very bottom of their website, what's called a browse wrap type of agreement, that if you went to check on it and looked through it, you would see the terms of service.
And does it say that you better check these terms of service before you put your credit card information in and buy this thing?
Absolutely not.
So it's over. So it strikes me that this is procedural unconscionability of the first order. So much so that it may obliterate the need to show substantive unconscionability. telegraphing to your colleague here, but I mean, is there any case that says you must have both? I mean, if you have overwhelming procedural unconscionability, you don't need substantive. It's just, it blots out the tornado that blots out the sun and wipes out the town, so you don't worry about it.
I believe the case law does say you have to have both.
You have to have both. So yes. If you don't have substantive unconscionability, you're
That's true, but it is a sliding scale. So, you know, you weigh it greater or lesser.
That's the point of slides, but there has to be some down here on substantive. Like, do I have this right? I just want to get this correct.
That is my read of the case law. Now, I'll be fair to say I've never seen a case that involves this level of procedural unconscionability.
I haven't either.
So I don't want to say definitively that you're not correct on that, but I believe the way the California law is set up requires at least a tiny bit. The case law suggests
kind of a new bait and switch. It's not your traditional bait and switch, but it's a different kind.
It's
you buy this thing, and then you find out, guess what?
Yes. Yeah, you do not have to agree to the terms of service at the time you buy the product. That's absolutely true. So, I believe
the district court judge felt that this was procedurally unconscionable. Best practices, you know, it's kind of outrageous in a way.
Yes, and obviously we have no qualms with her findings in that regard.
Can I ask you this? You just started by saying the way to approach the analysis here is to pretend that this is an agreement between the two parties without any kind of an arbitration overlay.
Mm-hmm.
So let's focus on that first term that you've challenged, the loser pays provision.
Okay.
Are there California cases in the context of parties who contract with one another to go to court where there's a loser pays provision and California courts have said that's substantively unconscionable? Do you have cases that say that?
Where it's bilateral and not unilateral.
Right. Well, I believe one of the cases they actually cited, the Lennar Holmes case, ultimately arrived at that conclusion. It's unusual in the sense that, you know, the loser pays type attorney fee shifting clause typically occurs in a commercial contract between two significant size organizations who have a lot of bargaining power.
So in the consumer context, I agree that's a different context.
Right.
In the consumer context, as Judge Acuda said, where there's a bilateral fee shifting provision, are there cases in California that say that that's substantively unconscionable on the assumption that the parties are going to go to court?
I have not seen that only because I have never actually seen that type of a term in a consumer contract. I don't have any problem believing that. If it was a consumer product and the seller of the product said in a term buried at the end of the contract, by the way, if you ever want to make a claim against us, you're going to pay us our attorney fees if you lose, that is substantively unconscionable. Can I point to a specific California case that has said that so far? No, only because I believe no business has had the gall to try that yet. Go ahead.
Opposing counsel cites the California Civil Code that seems to think the remedy for a unilateral prevailing parties clause is to make it bilateral, so it's hard to see why that would be substantively unconscionable when California statute requires that reading of a unilateral prevailing parties clause. They don't just say it's invalid as a matter of public policy. They say, no, we'll read it as being bilateral.
Sure, but I think that's a different circumstance. That's a situation where it's putting one party is going to claim attorney's fees and the other party doesn't get the right to. They're not addressing unconscionability at all in that context. That's a different analysis. The unconscionability looks at whether the term is going to be unfair to one party that has no bargaining power. And just as a whole string of cases have said in the arbitration context, a fee-shifting clause is unfair because it basically puts the party with no power in a position of assuming tremendous risk.
But outside of the arbitration context, there's not a case directly on point?
There is not. I think only because it's never been a circumstance that's come up. I've never seen a...
It's probably not true as an empirical matter because California does have a statute, as you're aware, I assume, in this very arbitration-specific, that says that this exact kind of attorney's fees shifting provision is invalid.
Right.
Any consumer contract that's going to be arbitrated, and I assume that you would agree that that's probably preempted now. But so obviously these kinds of contracts exist because California has provided for it in the arbitration context. And I guess I'm a little bit surprised that you aren't able to point us to cases in the, you know, people are going to go to court where courts have addressed this. If you're so confident that it's substantively unconscionable.
All I can say to that, Your Honor, is that it's a type of clause that shows up frequently in arbitration agreements, and so presumably the statute was enacted to rectify that particular problem. I can't say anything other than to say that I've looked at this area fairly thoroughly and have not come across a case specifically saying that an attorney fee shifting clause was either conscionable or unconscionable under these circumstances because it has not been raised.
In fairness, we've looked at that and we couldn't find a single case either. So that's why I was asking you, and I guess I'm reassured that our research wasn't deficient in that regard. But what are we supposed to do in the absence of any case law, one way or the other? You declare with utmost confidence that California courts would declare such a provision as this substantively unconscionable, but how do we know that? What other guidance do we look to make that determination?
Well, I think you look to, and I'm sorry, I'm running low on time here, so let me answer this question and then I'll take a seat real quick. I think you look to the cases that have discussed the policies behind why this type of arrangement is unconscionable. So even though they deal with arbitration because that's the circumstance in which they arise, in Armendariz and the other cases, the Supreme Court explained the reasoning behind this is because it puts the consumer at such a level of risk that no one is going to go to court. It essentially immunizes the defendant from suit because a consumer who manages to find this clause is going to say, I'm not going to take that risk. There's no way I'm ever going to go to court on a case like this. And so it preemptively cuts off any ability that they're going to have to try to get this. And so when we're looking at either arbitration or judicial process, if we treat the forums as equal, if it's unconscionable in the arbitration context, it's going to be unconscionable in the judicial context as well. We're looking at the forums as being the same type of remedy.
Some kind of a waiver floating around in here.
I do not believe there's you mean like a liability waiver or something like that?
Or fees or anything like that?
There's not. So what happened there was that, in their reply brief in our motion, in their attempt to compel arbitration, they came in and said, okay, we admit that this is perhaps not fair. We're going to waive enforcement.
I thought it said floating around.
Yes, it's not in the agreement itself. They made that as a later argument. Apparently, AAA actually told them it was unenforceable, and so they came in and said, all right, we agree it's not going to be enforceable, which a position they've now retracted on appeal. So that leaves me with only a couple minutes, so I'm going to take my seat while you still have a chance.
Good morning, Robert Varian, on behalf of Appley and defendant 23andMe. Let me say at the front end that there are two independent bases on which the judgment below needs to be affirmed, and the district court addressed one of them, and that was the absence of substantive unconscionability, which is clearly required. I'm here to defend that. That's fine. I think that's right. I'm happy to answer any questions the court has and go back to some of the questions that have been asked.
You cross-appeal at all the judge's conclusion that it was procedurally unconscionable?
No, but we didn't.
So that stands?
No, it does not. We did appeal that. So we appealed from the judgment, as I know the court understands well, that a judgment can be affirmed on any basis that's required by law and reflected in the record.
Do you accept the idea that this is procedurally unconscionable?
I think it is procedurally unconscionable, but let me just address that quickly, and I want to get back to the point I was hoping to make.
What's the second ground?
The second one is that it's preempted. It could be procedurally and substantively unconscionable, and it would be preempted.
What is
the
you can't do any unconscionability analysis?
No. So, okay, great. So I would suggest that the best way maybe to think about this is to look at this court's decision in Laster, which is the decision that was reversed by the Supreme Court in Concepcion, and compare Laster, this court's decision, which talks about all of these things, the standard sort of unconscionability arguments, to Mortensen, which is the subsequent decision in which this court addressed these things quite carefully. And in Mortensen, it said the landscape has changed. It used to be that if you had an unconscionability defense that that was generally applicable and that was enough under Section 2 of the FAA. What Mortensen says, and what all the cases say now, and it's compelled, is that no, that's not the analysis. It has a disproportionate impact on arbitration, on arbitration clauses, then it's preempted. And the reason for that is that the FAA.
You say it's preempted. What are you talking about?
The defense.
The thing we need to do here is to analyze these provisions, as your opponent said. Let's pretend that they were in the context outside of arbitration, right? And we just would decide whether California courts would declare that provision, even if it contemplated the parties going to court, whether they would declare it substantively unconscionable.
That's certainly part of the analysis, and let me address that directly. I think there's quite a bit more that I'd like to address as well, and I think I have limited time, so that's the problem here because it's a kind of a target-rich environment. But first, as the court seems to have done, we went and researched very carefully each one of these provisions that is at issue, every one of them, and found that none of them, not one of them, has ever been declared substantively unconscionable in any context other than arbitration. And that's really decisive under Mortensen, Concepcion.
The form selection provision, because there are California cases saying in the outside of arbitration that it can be unenforceable if the financial hardships on plaintiffs would preclude plaintiffs from asserting claims at all.
I think those are superseded now in the arbitration context, and it has to be reasonable. I think there's law out there.
You keep using preemption and superseded. I'm just not following your argument.
All right, let me try to make it as clear as I can. So Concepcion says, Mortensen says that what the Supreme Court has said now, and this is in American Colors also in the Supreme Court, very clear.
Arbitration is in, but not if the arbitration agreement is procedurally or substantively unconscionable under state law.
And it says
right
that,
or wrong.
To be disproportionate in its impact. And also, the typical, and this is in Italian Colors, it's picked up in Mortensen. In fact, let me read it from Mortensen, because that's probably the easiest place, but it's in other places as well, including Italian Colors. So in Mortensen, this court said that Concepcion established that the FAA's command to enforce arbitration agreements, remember that's what the FAA says, and that's what Concepcion hammered on, that's the principal primary purpose of the statute.
The agreement is lawful. Go ahead.
Trumps any interest in ensuring the prosecution of low-value claims. And if you think about it, that's really what Discover Bank is all about, too.
So I'll say Trump, you ran me all excited.
Sorry. That's the court's language.
I
can't make that up. But that's in other decisions in Italian Colors as well. But if there is no, and I can talk about any one of these provisions if anybody wants to, but and I can talk about substantive unconscionability, of which there is none, you need both.
That's what we're talking about right now. So let's go back to the venue selection provision.
Right.
Are you conceding that these can proceed as class arbitrations?
They are proceeding as class arbitrations.
Okay, you agree that that's what the contract contemplates, right?
I actually don't agree, but it's been determined, so it doesn't matter. There is no class action waiver.
That's good.
There's a lot of arguments on that that are not really at issue here. There are reasons, but
they might be because certainly that the district court, in saying that this venue selection provision was not unconscionable here, pointed out that six of the nine class actions were voluntary.
Yeah, they were.
So it's obvious if they're going to proceed as class actions that there's no issue with this being an unreasonable burden.
Of course. In fact, it's the other way, Your Honor. It's exactly the opposite. So they're proceeding as class actions. Everybody filed them or transferred them to California. Three of them were filed in San Francisco as class actions before the AAA. Everybody went to this forum. They thought it was the right place, which it so obviously is for all the reasons I won't belabor. And they're proceeding as class actions. And what does that mean? That means that the attorney's fee provision, and there is a California CCP section, which may or may not be preempted, doesn't matter, that says that you can't enforce a provision like that. And this is bilateral. Well, what it means is it gives all the leverage to the plaintiffs, not to the company or the defendants, because we've got, hordes, I don't mean that in a pejorative way, but many class action lawyers who are very good at running up big fees, as this court knows, and documenting them. And the company's on the hook for all of that. And conversely, there's no recourse whatsoever against the plaintiffs. They're not going to be responsible for anything.
Your opponent accused you of having retracted.
No, we haven't retracted it, Your Honor. It's very simple. There's a statute, as the court pointed out. The AAA said, hey, there's a statute. We said, fine, and it wasn't an issue.
Oh, I'm sorry. Back up a little bit. The other side says that you came up with this idea of waiver because somebody told you that this was defective. Is that what happened?
No, I think it's very, very simple.
Why did you come in and then waive this? You must have thought it was a problem.
No, I'll tell you exactly what happened. I think if it were still in there, it wouldn't make any difference whatsoever under the controlling law. But what happened factually is the AAA said there's a statute in the civil code that we think prevents us from administrating an arbitration where there's a clause like this. And we looked at it and said, fine. So it wasn't really a waiver. It's just a constant. That's the way it is. I mean, that's statutory. So there was no waiver. We haven't retracted anything. That's right.
But it is what it is.
Yeah, and you can have a reciprocal attorney's fees clause. There's no problem with that. In fact, there have been arguments made a number of times in cases and accepted. Actually, they haven't been accepted, but they've been made that the absence of a reciprocal fee provision is unconscionable because it deprives plaintiffs of the ability to do what the plaintiffs are doing here, which is file these lawsuits, run up big fees. The company's on the hook for the big fees if it loses, if it's a meritorious claim. And there's no reciprocity. Conversely, if the company prevails, there's no remedy. Obviously, there's no remedy. You can't chase the plaintiff's lawyers. You can't chase individuals. No one would ever do that.
Could you also address their argument that the exclusion of the IP claims from the requirement to arbitrate is unconscionable?
Sure. That is never going to come into play in any way, shape, or form in a dispute about the purchase of the PGS, which is what we have here. That's the product of Personal Genome Service. So it's really irrelevant. It's not going to be a factor. But moreover, it's bilateral, as the district court pointed out. And
is that the sort of claim that the stronger party, which in this case would be your client, is more likely to bring against the consumer?
It's not standard, I don't believe, Your Honor, respectfully. There are lots of cases that say the Supreme Court, other cases that say that you can choose which claims you want to arbitrate and not. There are some employment cases, which I think are preempted now, that said, look, in a situation where you have a non-reciprocal waiver, a non-reciprocal clause, and in an employment case, the employer can assert claims based on trade secrets, which would come up. That's an obvious sort of counterclaim. And those are reserved for courts. You can get an injunction. Those kinds of things. That there are issues there. I think those cases are preempted at this point. But this is a totally different situation. It's bilateral. It has nothing to do, nothing whatsoever to do. It's a complete non-factor in connection with any claim based on the purchase of this product. It's irrelevant.
What sorts of IP?
You know, I haven't delved into that deeply enough to give you an accurate answer, but there are a number of them. They're in our brief, I think, below in the record. The terms of service talk about, I'm actually not sure there could be a copyright claim.
IP rights to the customers. I don't know the IP rights and their genetic information, but I mean, there is language in the terms of service reserving to the customers certain IP rights.
That's correct. That's correct. And I don't have an accurate answer to that. I think there are copyright potential claims. I'm not sure what intellectual property rights you would have.
Don't you need to know the answer to that? Don't you need to be able to answer our questions for us to make an assessment?
Well, I wish I had a better answer, and I apologize for not having it.
It sounds like you haven't even bothered to think about it.
No, I have thought about it, and I've thought about it.
You have no answer, even though you've thought about it.
I have thought about it, and the answer is it's irrelevant, Your Honor.
That's what I'm saying. Let's say that we disagree with you, because I definitely disagree with you. So what's the answer?
The answer to the question, I can find it. It's in the record. It's in the terms of service. It talks about, the district court talked about it. They have intellectual property rights. But
okay, I'll go find it. It just seems odd that you've come to defend, and it's an obvious question.
Well, let me give an explanation. Let me provide an explanation, okay? It's irrelevant, and I understand the court disagrees, but here's my argument and position, which I think is well supported in the case law. It's irrelevant because the Supreme Court says you can choose which claims you arbitrate and which claims you don't. Second, it doesn't tilt the playing field as it might in an employer case. It's in this dispute, it has nothing to do with everything. It's not like somebody sues, an employee sues a company, and then the company asserts claims in court based on trade secrets and gets an injunction. It's irrelevant. It doesn't have anything to do. It's not substantively unconscious.
I disagree with you on that, because let's say that there was a particular set of claims in this context, like in the employer-employee context, that only the company would be likely to bring against the consumer, right? And you have an agreement, and there are no comparable claims within that category that the consumer would be likely to assert against the company. If you make the consumer arbitrate every single claim he or she might have against the company, but the one set of claims that the company might have against the consumer you allow or you basically exempt from the arbitration agreement, I do think our cases say that that's problematic. I don't know whether it's enough to declare the but that's the relevant question.
Right, Your Honor, I understand.
I have Concepcion, which says you can't make, I guess THI actually stated it, that you can't have state law that's predicated on the view that arbitration is an inferior means of vindicating rights. So that is our case law that Judge Wofford was alluding to is based on the premise that arbitration is inferior to litigation. So does that survive Concepcion?
No, and it's part of Concepcion. What Concepcion, what Imbergia, what this court said in Mortensen, what a lot of decisions now, Italian Colors previously, all say that, go back to Concepcion, the primary purpose of the FAA, Concepcion says primary and principal, is to ensure, and Mortensen's very good on this, her decision, that arbitration agreements are enforced according to their terms. And other decisions, including Mortensen and Concepcion in Italian Colors, say that that overarching federal policy trumps, I'm sorry, that's the word that they use, trumps the interest in ensuring litigation of low-value claims, which is the Discover Bank rule, and you see in other places, and it trumps it. It might be right, it might be wrong, I'm not arguing that point.
I have a view of the case that very well may be defective, and I'd like you to tell me where I'm mistaken. As I was discussing with your colleague at the bar, there's a product that's available for purchase, sale and purchase on the Internet. And it's, you know what the product is, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So you go on the Internet, and it says, here's what you're getting. There's an offer. You accept the offer. You pay for it. Is that what happens?
Yeah. So let me explain.
Okay. And so that's the way I look at it.
Yeah.
That's contract right now. It's over. You bought the product. And that's it. And there are no terms of service in the contract at that point. And so that's the end of it, and you don't even get to the terms of service. It's a contract, that's it. There's nothing in there about arbitration. That's why I say, is this a defective way of looking at the case?
It is, I believe it is, respectfully. So first, it goes to procedural unconscionability. But just on that point, forget about substantive unconscionability. The law is clear that you have to have both, and there's a whole preemption argument.
But my point is, there is nothing in the contract at all about the terms of service. Nothing, zero.
So, Your Honor, this is a product that can only be purchased on the company's website. That's the only place you can buy it.
Right.
On the website, on multiple pages, this is in the record, we cited the record, the district court noted. The district court was a little harsh on this, but at the bottom, there are links to the terms of service. That's on multiple pages. So
where can I see that?
If you look at the Hilliard Declaration, let me give you a record site, because I actually do have that.
Yeah, where's the Getting started is simple. Learn more about your ancestry today. Order now. I've got that order.
It's at the bottom. If you look at that.
When it arrives, be sure to register. When it arrives.
Your Honor, the product is really the service. I'm trying to get the court of reference on it because I said I would do that.
Pay anything additional for the service? Or is all payment?
No, but that's.
No.
You don't pay anything additional for the service.
So if you don't want to accept the terms of service when you register, then you've basically thrown away your money, or do you get a refund?
You can get a refund under certain circumstances, but Your Honor, but
how can you get a refund? It's 90 days or 3 days or something like that, or 90 hours?
So let me just back up a step. So first, the site, which I promised to give you, is to the Hilliard Declaration, and it's Exhibit C to the Hilliard Declaration, which is just an example, and that's the record site.
ER number?
144. 144. And it's at the bottom of the pages. But that would go to procedural unconscionability. You have to have both. And Sanchez reaffirmed.
My point is there are no terms of service in the contract. You bought the product. It says you're ordering right now. You order it. You buy it. And that's it. It's a contract. There's nothing in there at all about arbitration. And that is when it arrives, meaning you already bought it. You already bought the kit and the service. You don't put the kit on Antiques Roadshow or hang it on yourself. When it arrives, be sure to register. It's all over, but there's no terms of service when you bought it. The contract is consummated.
So, Your Honor, before the contract is consummated on this analysis, which I think is defective, but let me put that to one side respectfully, you have on the website, which is the only place you can buy this, on almost every page, multiple pages, something at the bottom. It's just a hyperlink to the terms of service, which you're supposed to read.
Where? I don't see it.
Your Honor, if you look at ER 144, and it's circled, terms of service.
Okay, at the bottom, it says order now, and then past that, it says about, partner with us, terms of service.
Correct. And that's on many pages, and the terms of service are, of course, the contract.
But it's over. You ordered, it's over.
It's what's known as a browse wrap, not to get into jargon.
I know that. I think this is really a bait and switch, a new kind. I bought the product, I got it, I think I'm getting all this stuff, and then hidden at the bottom it says terms of service. It's too late.
Well,
it's too late. It's not in the contract.
Well, Your Honor, it's you can only buy it on the website. It's not a situation where you buy something at Best Buy.
Or less if you only buy it on the website.
Well, the only place you can buy it is on the website. Because on that website, on multiple pages, are the terms of service, a hyperlink to the terms of service. It says legal and terms of service right there on multiple pages.
About arbitration.
No, Your Honor, that isn't true. You could easily hyperlink to the terms of service. They're right there.
You could easily tell them, too, when you order it, hey, guess what? You better read this because you're now in arbitration, not in court.
People are very happy with this product. It's selling.
Some aren't.
Well, we could debate that. But it's selling fabulously, and the terms of service are right there, hyperlinked on multiple pages, on the only place you can buy this product, which is on the website. It's right there. You could click on it and read it. It's not hidden.
I think Judge Cole was not even harsh enough when she described this.
Well, it would be different, and I don't want to debate this point because it goes to procedural unconscionability at most. You have to have both, and there's nothing in the universe that makes this substantively unconscionable.
In the contract.
Well, I can't. I won't. Belabor that point, but it's there. So, again, I would say two things at a high level, and one of them is that the court should affirm based on the absence of substantive unconscionability, which is required, and I think that's clear, and we briefed that. Totally separate and independent ground, there's a preemption argument, which we've made, and I won't repeat it, but it's very clear. And if the court looks at the cases, as I know Your Honors will, and especially
all that says preemption.
Yeah, lots of them.
They talk in terms of preemption.
Sure.
Name one.
Concepcion, Invergia, this court's opinion in Mortensen, Italian College.
State law on unconscionability.
Yes, if not all state law on unconscionability, but it has to be enforced exactly the same way. Your Honor, Mortensen, your decision says that it has to be enforced to the same extent. In this case, you can look at all of those provisions, every last one of them, and there is no case ever refusing to enforce them that we could find any of the provisions at issue here outside the arbitration context. That's it. It's not just a question of, hey, sometimes it's not enforced as rigorously, or if you did a tally, as Mortensen talks about, that it would be unbalanced. There aren't any on one side. It's not enforced at all. There's no substantive unconscionability decision outside the arbitration context. on any of these terms, and under Mortensen, Virgia, Concepcion, many other cases, that's preemption, and it trumps all of these other considerations about low-value claims like the Discover Bank rule, which are of legitimate concern, but that's the law. I didn't make it up.
We have your argument. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay, I just wanted to take my rebuttal time to answer a couple of the questions.
You can answer one of my questions first.
Yes.
The other side says I'm all wet looking at the case this way. This is, there it is, right at the bottom of the page, terms of service, so that's part and parcel of the contract, and I'm wrong to think that it's not. So when I see that 144, which is marked wherever the side says terms of service, if I click on that, what do I see?
If you clicked on that hyperlink, you would see the terms of service.
Which includes arbitration.
Correct.
Way back in paragraph 18 or something like that.
Correct. That, as counsel correctly pointed out, that's what they call the browse wrapper.
Right.
But so is there a California case outside of arbitration that says that the terms of such a contract are unenforceable if it's delivered via this browse wrap? What case is that?
Honestly, Your Honor, I don't know if that's ever come up outside of arbitration, but I know that there is a decision from this court, the Nguyen decision from 2014, holding that in the context of arbitration agreements, the browse wrap is not going to be enforced.
We can't really look at those cases anymore, right?
Well, this is a post-Concepcion, post-American Colors case, the Nguyen case. It's 2014. So it exists. It continues to be the law of the circuit beyond those two things, beyond those decisions. Yes, I can get you. Yes, correct, exactly.
Okay. That's 2014.
Yes. A couple quick points on the waiver issue, just because this came up. I have the excerpts of the record here. On ER, page 29, this is Judge Koh. She says, however, 23andMe represents that it has formally waived any right to recover attorney's fees and costs at the request of AAA. Accordingly, the court declines to consider whether or not this provision is substantively unconscionable. See reply at 11. So they came in on reply and said, we're going to waive this. That's exactly what happened. There's really no other way to spin that.
So the Nguyen case in Europe, got it as Fed second in one place, it's Fed third.
Fed third, correct, Your Honor. On the intellectual property issue, I managed to find that as well. Let me get the citation for you here. So that's ER 29, 43, and 46 are sort of the constellation of things. But basically what it allows is it gives the consumer the right to republish the actual results of their test. They don't retain any rights in the test results themselves.
What are the claims, the IP claims, that 23andMe is likely to bring against customers?
Well, 23andMe is primarily in the data collection business, and so although they give these tests back, they've indicated what they're really doing is they're creating this DNA genetic data bank, and they retain all of the rights in that information because that information is worth a tremendous amount of money.
What's the IP claim that 23andMe would bring against the consumer?
Well, so presumably if the consumer is going to make any sort of public disclosure about that DNA information, to the extent that the consumer has...
Now, what they're allowed to do, they reserve that right under the contract?
The consumer has the rights to republish their own test results.
Okay, and so the likely claim that 23andMe would bring against the consumer is that the consumer shouldn't publish anybody else's data, and why would the consumer be likely to have anyone else's data?
I don't know that the consumer would.
But what is the claim? IP claim?
Well, I have to premise this by saying I'm not an intellectual property lawyer, but the claim is what 23andMe here is doing is trying to retain, all of the intellectual property rights.
Okay, and what's the cause of action? I just want to hear what the cause of action would be. What would be the claim against a consumer?
It would have to be some sort of copyright infringement claim.
Okay. Well, we took you over your time as well. Could you wrap up, please?
Certainly. I just want one final thing, because I think this is important. Your Honor had asked about the class action aspects. 23andMe is vigorously fought in the arbitration proceedings that this was amenable to class action treatment. So far as when they lost one and they won one, I don't know how that happened. We ended up with irreconcilable results, but they attempted to petition the one that they lost to the district court. They have never for a second conceded that this is going to go forward as a class action.
I concede that today, and that's the basis on which I'm prepared to decide the case. So, I mean, I don't know how else you interpret your opponent's remarks today. He said clearly that we should analyze the venue selection provision on the assumption that these are going to proceed as class arbitrations, and he said there's nothing in the contract that prevents that.
Well, if that's the position he's going to take, that would be the first time I've ever heard that. I think he's saying that it's going forward as a class arbitration because an arbitrator's already decided that. I don't believe, and you can ask him, but I don't believe he's going to agree that that's their position. If they want to say to this court today that we're prepared to acknowledge these cases are going forward as a class action and arbitration, that is a completely different circumstance.
That's the concession that I'm prepared to decide the case on. I won't speak for my colleagues, but that's what I heard.
Well, I'm willing to accept that concession if that's what he's willing to make, but I don't
know.
Okay, I apologize, Your Honor.
Thank you.